Welcome on a stage, Mr. Denis Vregop from Internology Europe BV.
All day long I've been waiting to hear my pronunciation of my name been completely wrong. It's Vroegop. It's not that hard, is it? It's Dutch, I know. It means early riser, and I got up this morning at 6, so I think it's appropriate. Thank you for having me. It's been a blast today. I've been to a lot of conferences all over the world, but this is one of the best I've ever been to, really. So kudos to the organization, and great for having me here. I'm going to be talking about HoloLens today. Question, which of you have been working with HoloLens before? None. Who has seen a HoloLens device in real? Two. Okay, well, here it is. Any questions? I'm going to be talking a bit more. I'm going to be talking about HoloLens today. I'm going to be talking about mixed reality, augmented reality, virtual reality, that kind of thing. I'm going to be showing you what it is, what you can do with it, and more important, how you can develop for this. Who are you, our developers? C#? Okay, for those of you who don't worry, I'll explain every single line. It's not that hard. This is being recorded. I hope none of my customers will actually see what I'm talking about here, but it's really simple to do this. Don't tell my customers that. I'll tell them it's very complicated, very expensive, but in reality, it's very easy. Anybody can do this. I have to apologize first. I'm going to be showing some code, and we have some problems displaying things on this big screen. I'll explain what I'm doing. The PowerPoint will be just fine, but the code will be hard to read. So look at those screens, and I'll tell you what's going on anyway. So don't bother about it. Let me start out with this one first. This is a quote by Douglas Adams. Douglas Adams was the writer of The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. It's a trilogy in 5 parts. Kind of weird. The context doesn't really matter, but at a moment in the book he said, "A computer terminal is not some clunky old television with a typewriter in front of it. It's an interface where the mind and body can connect with the universe and move bits of it about. And this is the world I want to live in." Not this one. This is where we are right now. We still work with typewriters in front of televisions. Okay, we've got touch screens and mice and things like that, but this is still it. Technology is hard. Technology is hard to understand. It's hard to operate. This is where you want to go. We're not there yet. We'll get there, but it will take some time. But I think that this device is getting us in the right direction. This is the HoloLens. I've got a real live one here. Don't want to drop it. Okay. This, if you don't know what it is, it's a fully untethered portable computer, which means that it's got more processing power than the average laptop that people have. And I'm not talking about your devices, your tech people. You've got very expensive hardware at home, I think. But the average user, they buy a laptop for, let's say €500, which is about 2,000 zlotys, I think. This is more powerful than that one. It contains everything that you need. You don't need anything. It's not connected to anything. It doesn't have any wires attached to it. You can just put it on and walk around. Well, how does it work? Well, the whole thing is based on sensors. Everything in it is a sensor. There's a whole bunch of camera sensors, to be exact. There are 4 grayscale cameras to each side of it. And what they do, they are here on the side. The only thing that they do is they take constant pictures of the environment, which means if you put it on, it will take a snapshot of the environment. The moment that you move about a bit, it will take another picture, and it will calculate the difference between those two, and it knows, hey, the user has moved. Which means that it can also change the picture it's displaying. Which means that to the user, it will appear that you have moved and the picture will stay in place. I'll show you later on. Very important. You don't need any external sensors. For people who have been using the HTC Vive virtual reality system or the Oculus Rift, they've got these lighthouses, which means there are external cameras that are tracking you, what you're doing. You don't need it. Everything is built into the device. That's that. This one's pretty cool. This is the depth sensor. Basically, what it does is it emits an infrared light beam, which is, of course, being reflected by the objects in front of it. It will be detected by the other one, and it will calculate, determine on the time that it takes to bounce back, how far things are. Which means that the HoloLens knows in 3 dimensions how far everything is. It knows where the floor is, for instance, and it knows where the ceiling is, and etc. Now, it takes about 0.2 seconds to do this. Which means that it takes about, it does this 5 times per second. So if somebody walks by, it will be about a second before they are out of view again. So the HoloLens will ignore it. So no, you cannot track people. You can track floors, tables, that sort of thing, telly things. So it knows where things are, which means that if I've got an hologram, if I've got an image, and I place it under this table and I'm standing above it, I will not be able to see that image because there's something in the way. Which is, of course, very natural for people. I mean, I can't look through this table. Nobody can. Superman does, but I cannot do that. HoloLens mimics this kind of behavior. Of course, you can also go the other way around. You can place things in a wall or behind a wall and see through the wall if you want to. I'll talk a bit later on. This one is pretty funny. These are microphones. We've got four microphones in the device. They are tilted a bit, and they are focusing around this area in front of your mouth. Why? Well, for two reasons. One, it will pick up your voice so you can give voice commands, and only your voice, which means that if your friend is standing next to you, she will start shouting, "Format C, reboot everything, delete all," it will ignore this. You can trick this, and I'm not going to tell you how to do this, because otherwise you'll mess up my demos, but usually it just picks up your voice. The other thing that it does is it will also ignore the environment noises around it. It will only pick up your voice, and everything else will be ignored. And last year I was doing this talk in Las Vegas, and I don't know if you've ever been to Las Vegas, but those places are noisy. There's a lot of things going on there. So I decided to try out how good it actually was. So I put it on, and I went into this casino. There were a lot of gray-haired old women sitting there behind a slot machine throwing in money all night long. It's terrible. You don't want to go there. But it was very noisy. And I tried out how good the system was, how good it was at recognizing my voice. And I learned two things. It works fantastic. And the other thing I learned is security people in a Las Vegas hotel don't appreciate it if you stand next to a roulette table with this kind of thing on your head. I got escorted out of the building pretty quickly that moment. But okay, it works fine. So then, of course, I had to give a demo to the guys what's going on. Never mind. These are the sensors. There are no accelerometers. There are no gyroscopes. There's nothing like that. All camera and microphone based. Okay, so if you have input, then you also need output. And this is the output system, and this picture is a bit misleading. This is actually how it works, but there is a tiny strip at the bottom of these on two sides. It's about 1 centimeter high. That's your display, so it's pretty small, but it's in front of your eyes, so it feels a bit bigger. But there are two displays, which means we have stereoscopic field. That's not 3D, not the 3D that you know in movies. If you go to a movie theater these days, everything is 3D. But that's ridiculous. It's not real 3D. Next time you go to the theater, and there's always one scene in the movie where the director decides to frighten the audience. So something is falling down or coming towards you, just to scare you a bit. Next time that happens, what you should do is move your head a bit. Not go too far, because then you're in front of the other guy next to you and they don't like this. But you will notice that the object in front of you will move with you. Which makes sense, because everybody in the audience needs to have the same kind of experience. I mean, the guy sitting at one end of the row needs to have the same kind of view as the guy on the other end. This doesn't work in real life. If something comes towards you and you step to the side, it will move next to you. HoloLens knows how you move about, so it will adjust the picture accordingly and it will feel like it's a real thing. So it's real 3D. I'll show it later on. One thing, the field of view is kind of small. It feels like you're having a monitor this big in front of you. So this is not virtual, this is all virtual. That's not a problem. Everybody who puts on the device for the first time will say, the field of view is way too small, and then they start interacting with all the things that they see, and they forget completely about the field of view. So in reality, it's not a problem. Should it be bigger? Yes, of course. I want everything to be bigger. I want the whole thing to be screen-filling. But it's not really an issue, so never mind that too much. It would be a problem if it was virtual reality, but I'll get to that later on. Okay, so, well, of course, like I said, it's a portable computer, so it's got a big computer in front of it, ahead of it. It's all based in this part. It's got a processor, it's got a graphical processor, it's got some memory, it's got a sort of SSD inside of it. It's not that complicated, but one thing that makes it outstanding from its competitors, it's got this thing they call the HPU, which is called the Holographic Processing Unit, which is a dedicated chip. Somewhere here, I've got no idea where it is, I'm no hardware guy, but what this does is takes all this image data coming from the cameras and the microphone, and it will translate that into events for the computer. Because this is just a Windows 10 computer. It runs Windows 10. Special version, but it does run Windows 10. Which means that if you make a gesture with your hands, because that's how you control it, Windows 10 will just receive a mouse click. It doesn't even know that you're doing this kind of thing. It will get a mouse click anyway. Which means that all the hard work is being done in hardware and the software doesn't have to do that much. And if you look at the processor, if you run an application, it doesn't do much. And all the competitors do this in software. If you look at the things that Apple is doing nowadays with ARKit and the AR Core from Google, they do everything in software, which makes it a bit slower. This is the reason that Microsoft is about still 5 years ahead of the competition. Works fantastically. This is quite funny. These are the speakers. Now you might say to yourself, okay, sound speakers, what's so special about those? This is spatial sound, which is completely different from stereo sound. If you listen to stereo, nothing in the world makes stereo sound. Well, stereo systems, but that's the only thing. Stereo doesn't exist. I'm talking to you guys and my voice is coming, well, from the speakers, of course, but it's coming from my mouth here. But people are very, very good at finding the source of sounds. If I walk about, you will hear me where I am. With stereo, we can only do left and right. With spatial sound, we can do left, right, top, bottom, behind you, in front of you, everywhere. So if you have a sound coming from the system, it will feel like it's coming from wherever the hologram is, behind you, in front of you, doesn't really matter. And this is extremely important. The reason this is so important is, like I said, the field of view is fairly limited. Now imagine I'm playing a game. I'm playing some shooter kind of game, and there's a robot somewhere in the area that wants to shoot me. It's a spatial system, so it could be anywhere. It could be in front of me, but it could also be to my side. But if it's to my side, I can't see it because I'm still seeing only this part. Which means it can take its gun and point at me and then shoot, and then I lose points, and I hate that because I don't like losing games. So I don't like that. But if he takes this gun, and the moment he does it, I hear this click-click sound. The first reaction everybody has is look to the source of the sound, look to the side, see the robot duck away and shoot back and win the game. Yay, we're winners. So 3D sound, spatial sound, adds realism to the whole thing and gives you a way of finding the object that you need to interact with. The nice thing is the speakers are above your ears, not in front of your ears. That means that if you wear it, you can still hear what's going on. That's a nice thing about the vision part as well. It's transparent, so you can put it on, and in theory, you can walk around without tripping over things. I'm saying in theory because everybody does the same thing. They put it on and they get distracted and they still trip. But in theory, you can walk around and see what you're doing. Especially since you're not attached to any cables, you can walk around. You can even leave the room if you want to. Don't do it, I'll come after you because I want it back, but in theory, you could do this. Okay, so well, some stats about it, not important. It's just a simple Intel Atom processor. Just 32-bit Windows running on it. It's got about 4 gigs of memory. It's got some 2 gigs of memory. It's got 64 gigs of storage. It's really a low-power device compared to your mobile phone with extra sensors and, of course, this special chip on board of it. We also have a 3.5mm audio jack still on board. Some brands decided to drop this, but Microsoft still keeps on using it. But this is about it. There's nothing fancy about it. Now, what can you do with it? Well, a lot. It's very simple technique, but the things that you can do with it are mind-blowing. This is, for instance, this is Volvo. If you go to Seattle and you want to buy a car, stop by Volvo. You're not going to do this, I think, but okay. If you want to do this, you can go there. They've got two devices there. You can put them on, and you can use them together. So you can customize your car. I want this model. I want this color. I want this trimming on it. I want this kind of wheels on it. You name it. And if you go there with your partner, you can, on the spot, make an argument about the color. I want it red. No, I want it blue. No. Because the decisions you make and the changes that you make on the car will be shown by the both devices. You cannot sit in the car because you will fall to the floor. It's all fake. It's virtual. You can walk around, you can look at it from different sides. Volvo sells 20% more cars here than they did before. 20% more cars. Why? Because people who put on a device, go away. People who put on a device feel like their car is already there. It's real 3D. It's not 3D like in the cinemas. So they got an emotional connection with the thing. They've also reported that once the car has been delivered after 2 months, people feel a bit disappointed. The whole sense of getting the new car you don't really know yet is gone because you've already seen it. So Volvo doesn't care about it because by then the car's already sold, so that's okay. Another example is Lowe. Lowe is a do-it-yourself chain in the United States, and they sell a lot of things, and including that they sell kitchens. So you go there with a floor plan of your kitchen. You say, okay, this is where the window is, this is where the door is, this is where the gas comes in, this is where the water comes in. And they put in a computer and you can design your kitchen. Again, two devices. So you can create your kitchen And you can walk around in it. I want the table to be a bit higher, and I want the refrigerator door. No, I want it to be the other way around, and that's a very expensive refrigerator. Let's put another one in. And you can whole customize your kitchen that way, and you can order it. And you can walk around it before you've even bought anything. They are not telling us how much more kitchens they are selling, but they are deploying these to 20 more stores, so I think they're doing okay. Trimble, they use it for architecture. I mean, they're building a nice hotel across the road, I just noticed. Before you start building, you want to see what the building looks like. And nowadays they build mock-ups, they build models of buildings. And those models are extremely expensive to make. It's all cardboard, and somebody has to make this and cut all the pieces of cardboard and glue them together. With this, you can just put it, the drawing of your building in AutoCAD, like they do nowadays anyway, export it to the HoloLens, and then see the thing in 3D before you. You can walk around it, you can see it for real. And decide, this is not a good idea, we should move things the other way around and make changes on the fly without being bothered with things like cardboard and glue again. That's what they do. This one is one of my favorite. This is Scott Kelly. Scott Kelly was an astronaut on board the International Space Station. And they delivered two devices to the International Space Station. They are still being used. They started with two, but those went up in the air, literally, because the rocket exploded. That's too bad. But the other two arrived there. And what happens is, if there is an experiment to be done on board the spaceship, or if there's a repair to be done, or anything, if something needs to be done, and they need a certain kind of expertise for this. In the old days, what they did is they just uploaded a PDF file to the astronaut, and the astronaut had to go study this for hours and hours to know exactly what was asked of him. Nowadays, he puts on a device. The expert stays on Earth. Scientists don't like to go into space, so they stay on Earth. They start up Skype, which is just your regular old Skype that everybody uses. And they connect to the HoloLens. And the people on Earth can see through the eyes of the astronaut. And they can add annotations. They can place a movie in a corner telling me how to do. And they have 3D arrows, press this button, and that kind of thing. So this highly skilled astronaut is nowadays reduced to a monkey pressing buttons. And that's all he does, I think. So I think that's why he looks so angry, but no. Scott's back on Earth nowadays. The HoloLens are still there, and they're still being used every single day. I'll let you in on a little secret. I told you before, there are no gyroscopes inside of the thing. The reason for this, and there's no accelerometers, they don't work very well in space. NASA was one of the launching customers, so they told Microsoft, you know, this is all going to be fun, but make it camera-based. It should work here as well. Well, if it's good enough for space, it should be good enough for us as well. Anatomy. You can imagine if you have a lecture where you study about the human body, this is a great way to do. Just have a virtual body there. You can walk around it. You can look inside of it. This is very hard to do with a real human body. They do this, of course, in medical school, but it's kind of expensive, kind of gross, because you have a dead body that you need to examine. I hope that in the end people will study real bodies before they start operating on me, but this is a great way to start. They can do all sorts of virtual operations and surgeries on people before they start cutting for real. The estimation is that a medical student, will graduate 25% faster than they do nowadays, because it's so much easier to learn. They can do it over and over and over again. There's one other case study that I'd like to show you, which is actually a case study that I did myself, which was based in the Netherlands. There was this elder lady who fell down, and she broke her hip. She was 92 at the time. She broke her hip. She needed a hip replacement. And after that, she was afraid to get out of the house. Because what happens if I fall again? Will I die? Will I get in the hospital again? Will I get hurt again? So she doesn't trust her body anymore. And we try to think of a system that helps her. Now, I had some problems with my PC, so I hope there's sound. But anyway, it's going to be translated anyway, and you don't understand Dutch, so there's sound. This is what we did.
Binnen de fysiotherapie zijn Omring en Gezondheidscentrum Kersenpoog de eerste die de HoloLens toepassen. Met de HoloLens train je ten eerste lichamelijke functies, zoals behouden van balans. Daarnaast train je spierkracht, maar belangrijk is ook dat je zeer zeker cognitieve functies traint. We doen op dit moment een experiment met valpreventietraining bij ouderen die een vergroot valrisico hebben. De voordelen van het werken met de HoloLens is dat de patiënt in de eigen ruimte kan oefenen en dat creëert een stuk veiligheid. De patiënt ziet zijn of haar eigen omgeving en krijgt daar voorwerpen te zien die de patiënt moet ontwijken.
Ja, verschillende dingetjes die je dus ziet en natuur je natuurlijk. Wat is dit nou, wat is dat nou? En ja, en dat dan die ballon op je afkomt en die bal. Ja, ik vond het hartstikke leuk allemaal. Als ze weer komen, zou ik het weer doen.
To come again, I'll do it again. What we did, we went there 4 times, and after 4 times, she was brave enough to get out of the house again. What happens was the following. We put on the device. Can you imagine this? She lives in this very tiny apartment. So the first time we tried it out, I was there, being the lead of the system. The developer was there, Tom. The manager of the house where she lived was there. The physiotherapist was there. The cameraman was there. The sound man was there. The IT manager of the building was there. There were about 9 people in this tiny little room. And she was panicking. Do I need to make coffee for everybody? She said, no, don't worry about it. Just sit down and we'll put on the device, as you saw in the video. And the only thing you need to do is if you see a balloon, try to grab it. But if you see a soccer ball, get out of the way. In the beginning, she didn't do anything. She just stood there. What's going on? How is this possible? I mean, she's 94 years old. Can you imagine that? So she stood there. She did this. And it was funny because after a couple of minutes, we noticed that the moment that we had a football coming towards her, she started to move to the side. You saw this in the video as well. And she noticed it as well after a while. So she learned that if something happens that I'm not expecting, my body will react. And I can respond to this. And I can trust my body to do the right thing. So after 4 sessions, she said, you know what, I'm ready to go outside again. And if you can do this with software, I think you're doing a great job. So this is the kind of thing that we do. Okay, it's all about the experience. It should be a great experience. But the thing is, of course, development. Again, development is pretty simple. There are just some things that you need to know and that you need to take care of. The most important step, of course, is this one. This is the hardest. I cannot teach you this. What are we going to build? I don't know. You should have a great idea. I can tell you, but I won't, because then you're going to be my competitor. But this is the hard thing, because you have to think in a completely different way of about computing. You're not having a user sitting behind of a screen, or you're going to have a user inside of his environment. If you're a game developer, you might be familiar with the idea that you can control a character running through a world, but you can limit where this character can go. I mean, he cannot leave this world, for instance. If you're a race car driver in a virtual game, then you can drive on the road. With a HoloLens, the user can walk anywhere you want. You don't know. How big is the room going to be that the user is in? What's he going to do? Have you ever thought about the backside of an OK button, what it looks like? You probably haven't. But you should think about it when you're working with HoloLens. If there's a screen here, I could walk around it. So you need to think about this kind of thing. So this is the hard one. Once you've got this figured out, the rest is easy. Okay, step one, choose the platform. Now, the title of my talk is mixed reality, and that's the new term that Microsoft is using nowadays to describe this kind of technologies. It's not easy. These are the kind of devices that Microsoft is offering nowadays. They used to be called virtual reality devices, now they're called mixed reality devices, and that's just a marketing term. It's virtual reality besides, well, that one, of course, there's a HoloLens, but these are the virtual reality devices. The nice thing is that if you start developing for HoloLens, your software can be used on these devices as well. There are some changes that you need to do. This is virtual reality, which means that you're completely in an opaque environment. So you need to draw something there, but otherwise the software will run on all these devices. They're just basically Windows 10 applications, so you can run them on that. I just want to clarify a bit because, well, augmented, virtual, mixed realities, those kind of terms you hear all the time, it's not that complicated, but Microsoft calls everything mixed reality. Could be augmented reality, could be virtual reality, whatever. Augmented reality is Google Glass. I'm wearing a pair of glasses here. That's not Google Glass, it's normal glasses. But the Google Glass was just like this, but it had a display in this corner, which felt like a bit having a screen here. And if you moved about, the screen moved with you. It was connected to your phone, so the moment you walked through a street and had GPS connection, and you're walking by a window shop, and a shop window, and you see this. Okay, the shoes are on sale right now. You could see this in your screen. And that's basically all it did. So it's just adding another layer to the reality. Pokemon Go is another example. They try to be more or less 3D, but it's not really. So it's just adding something. On the completely other end of the spectrum, you get virtual reality, which means, okay, we've got this world, we love it, but it's not good enough, throw it away, let's create a new one. So you're in a completely enclosed environment, sometimes you even wear headphones, so you don't hear anything, you don't see anything, which is great, because if you want to build a game which is focused around being in a spaceship or in a medieval castle or whatever, this is cool, you can change this, you can do this. HoloLens sits somewhere in between, but Microsoft calls everything mixed reality because there's a mix between reality and virtual reality somewhere. It's just marketing. Again, HoloLens is doing, well, just adding things to completely mixing things because it's 3D. Mobile device nowadays can do a lot of augmented reality. Again, Pokemon Go, think that kind of thing. The new things coming out with ARKit and ARCore, they go a bit further than this because they also have depth knowledge. They know a bit about the environment they're in, so they know where the tables are and things like that, just like HoloLens does. Not as good as HoloLens, so that's why it's not getting all the way there. But it's getting better. And of course, on the other end of the side, we got the Oculus Vive, Windows Mixed Reality, Samsung Gear, you name it, all these kind of devices, which are completely opaque. So now you know, mixed reality. This is the one I'm talking about today. Okay, so we got step zero, we got step one, now we got step two, choose the development platform. That's going to get a bit more technical, but if you want to go developing for HoloLens, you've got basically two choices. One is go for DirectX, the other one is go for Unity. Okay, I'll just skip over this pretty quickly because I want to show you. DirectX is native on hardware. It's the default platform for graphics and audio on the Microsoft platform. So if you want to build a game for Microsoft Windows, you're going to use DirectX. There's no other way around it. It's a standard for high-performance application and games. It's all COM-based, C++. Trust me, if you are not a hardcore C++ developer, don't go there. This is terrible. It will keep you awake at night. If you are a C++ programmer, hats off to you. You're a better developer than I am, but I wrote a book about it. It's terrible. You don't want to go there. But it's powerful. It's fast. It's native. But it takes a long time to learn and takes a long time to build applications on this. So let's not talk about this one anymore. Let's talk about Unity. Unity is one of the two standard gaming platforms. The other one is Unreal. It's an environment where you can develop games, but it's also a runtime. It's multi-platform. There are more than 26 platforms supported nowadays. If it has a chip in it, probably Unity will run on it. The nice thing is it's free. You can download it and use it for free. There used to be a restriction on it. The free version only supported games running on Windows, Mac, or Linux, and that's about it. And if you wanted to do something else, you had to pay for it. Nowadays, if you are using as a hobbyist or a small company with less than $100,000 revenue, in euros, same thing, you can use it for free. There are no restrictions on it. There is a difference between the free version and the paid version. There are two differences. If you use the free version, your application will start up with the logo made with Unity. If you have the paid version, you can disable this. But more important, if you have the free version, your editor is light gray. If you have the paid version, you can choose between light gray and dark gray in your editor. Hey, that's worth about 30 euros a month, right? I mean, that's it. Basically, they're the same. You can make applications, you can make games, you can sell them, you can put them in the marketplace, you can make money out of it, no problem whatsoever. Just make sure that you don't go over this $100,000. Because then you have to pay them. Well, if you make more than $100,000 on a game per year, it's not going to be a problem. Okay, it uses mono runtime, versus real, doesn't really matter. It's easy, fast result, industry standard. It is a little bit less flexible than DirectX, and it's lacking in features slightly. Spatial audio is not as well developed, for instance, as it is on the DirectX side. Doesn't really matter. Okay. If you want to develop these kind of applications, you need to be a developer. Kind of makes sense. You need to do some scripting. It's not very hardcore. I'm talking about Unity here. I'm not talking about DirectX. Forget about that one. But if you want to do some Unity development, I'll show you Unity later on. It's pretty easy to use, but if you want to do some scripting, you need to do some development. So you need to know what a variable is. You need to know what a procedure is. You need to know what a class is, these kind of things. It's not that hard, but you have to know this. But besides that, there are some things that you need to know, especially for the HoloLens, which is this list of things. World coordinates, gaze input, gesture input, voice input, spatial sound, and spatial mapping. And I'll go through them. World coordinates. Again, we are working in a 3D environment, not 2D. We don't have one screen. We have a whole world that we need to take into account. Where in the world are we? Where in the world is the user? Where are the things happening? If I have a game with robots flying around me and I'm sitting in a room which is pretty small, how do I deal with this? Will it be flying very tightly around my head, or will it be disappearing behind a wall? You don't know. 3D worlds are different than 2D worlds. This is one of the hardest things to learn. Sounds so simple. Gaze input. There's no keyboard. There's no mouse. There's gestures, but there's gaze input. You have to look at things. You need to tell the user what to do. I'll show you later on in a code sample. So you need to be aware of this. Same as gesture input. There's one gesture you can use. I hope in the next version there will be more, but right now there's one gesture, which is the air tap, which is this. Okay, there are variations. You can tap, tap and hold, tap, hold and move, but it's the same thing. There's also another gesture, but this is just go to the start menu or exit the application. So this is the only thing you can use in your application. So you need to be aware of this. You are very limited. Yes, you can hook up a virtual keyboard to it, but you don't want to go there. You can hook up a physical keyboard to the HoloLens. You don't want to do that at all. I mean, if you have this on and you're walking around with a keyboard in your arms, then you're doing it wrong. So this is all we have. If that's not enough, we can use voice input. Like I said, there are four microphones in it meant to be used for your voice. You can have global commands, reset, or you can have specific commands. You look at an object and you tell this object, do this for me, which is very easy. I mean, that's very natural. People work this way. If I would ask you to turn off the light because it's shining right in my face, I look at you and you know I'm not talking to you guys because I'm looking at him. That's how it works here. You look at an object and you give it a command. So you need to do this. Spatial sound. I've talked about this before. This robot standing in the corner. If it makes a sound and I look at it, it gives a bit of realism and you can find the objects. There are no other platforms that do spatial sound. You don't have spatial sound on your laptop. Virtual reality, augmented reality does have this. And of course, the big one is spatial mapping. It knows where the environment is. It knows where the floor is. So you can do something. You can put objects on the floor and not through the floor. It will find the floor itself. You can have objects fall to the floor and it will know where to stop. I will show you that in my demo. You can have hide objects behind walls, or you can give the user superpower. I did a project for a building company in the Netherlands a year ago. And they had this big old building and we needed to have some new door in a wall. But we didn't want them to cut through the water lines, water pipes. So what we did, we took the drawings of all the water pipes, put them in a HoloLens, put them on the builder's head, and he could see inside the wall and see the water pipes there, so he knew where to drill. Downside was they gave us the wrong drawings. So you guessed it, he started drilling, and luckily he had not the device on, because he had a marking first, and then turned it off, and then he started drilling, and it was a whole water show, and terrible. But that was not the fault of the device. So you can give your user superpowers. I can talk about it for hours. I'm not going to do this. I'm just going to show you. Again, there's going to be a slight issue with the code on the screen, but I hope it will be visible on those anyway. Let me see if my environment started up already. Cool. Okay. Here we are. We have Unity. Now, the font is extremely small, and I cannot enlarge it. So I will tell you everything that I'm doing. I'm going to start a new project. Now, this is kind of brave of me to do. I'm running a preview insider version of Windows 10. And I'm using a preview insider version of Unity on that preview insider version of Windows 10. So if things go wrong, then we'll just see what happens. Let's be brave. Code Europe. Okay. For those of you who haven't seen Unity, who's worked with Unity before? Quite a few. Okay, but not everybody. Okay. Again, it's a game development environment. Sort of. Come on, where are you? There you are. Visual Studio Quest. Cool. Here we are. Basically, what you do, it's not really a development environment. It's more composing things. You've got a world. I'll show you in a minute. And you place stuff there. And you change those things. And you give them behavior. And you add some scripting to it. But basically, what it does is crashing by the look of it. Come on. Still starting up. Basically what you do is you just have a world and you place your object there. I want a dinosaur here and I want a fighter jet there, and if I look at the fighter jet and shoots dropping bombs on the dinosaur, that kind of thing. That's what you do. You're not really developing. The moment that you start developing is when you go to Visual Studio or another development environment and you start typing in your scripts. Come on. Using the HoloLens device. Come on. Great. If you have worked with Unity before on other devices, you will be disappointed because the workflow is terrible. If you use Unity, you can deploy to a device and run it from within Unity, which is what you want. I mean, I do a change, I want to see what it looks like. You cannot do that on HoloLens. You have to go through Visual Studio. I'll show it later on, but it takes a lot of time. In the latest versions that I have on my work machine back in at home, which is a way more powerful machine than this one, so I didn't bring it, you can do some more or less live previewing, but it's not the kind of thing that you want to do on a laptop. So, okay, here we are. This is my environment. As you can see, I've got this nice world here, and it's got a nice blue sky, and this is where everything takes place, which is great, because we're talking about 3D games. And 3D games need to live in a 3D kind of environment. However, this doesn't apply to the HoloLens. We don't need this. We got this. So who needs this? So let's get rid of this one. We've got a whole set of things on this side, on the this side of the screen, and those are the things that I'm using currently in my application. So it's got a camera and it's got a light. Well, we need a light, otherwise we can't see anything. And we need a camera, and the camera is basically the HoloLens. So if I go to the camera, and again, it's not very readable here, but if I go to the camera, I can tell it where to position it. I have to position it at position 000 in the world, because the user always starts out in the middle of the world. And then I tell, you know what, if I don't give you anything to draw, if there are no objects, don't draw this world, but just draw a solid color. Which solid color? Well, make it black. And why do I want to make it black? Because the HoloLens is a device that adds light to the real world. And black is the absence of light. Which means that although Unity thinks, come on, where are you? Unity thinks this is what the world looks like, it doesn't render anything, so I can see the actual real world. Which means that your object cannot be black. If you want to have a big Darth Vader kind of figure, forget about it. It's not going to work. If you have tiny black objects surrounded by a bright environment, it will work. I've got a demo application on it, and it shows a little puppy dog, and you can position it on the stage. And it's got a black nose. And you will see a black nose. I've been doing this talk for over 200 times, and I still see that black nose. Although I know it's transparent. But our brain fools us. It says, you know what, doesn't have a transparent nose. I've never seen that kind of dog. So it must be black, so that's what we see. So we make this black. Here you still see the world. That's not how it will be rendered. Okay, what can we do? Well, let's say I want to have some objects, and I want those objects to fall down to Earth. I told you, HoloLens knows about the environment. It knows where things are. So if there's a floor there, it will drop things to the floor. So let's see how that actually works. Well, it's not that hard to do. What we do is we have create empty, which is just a placeholder. I'll call it holograms. And I'll just add stuff to it. Now, Unity is not meant to be a 3D design environment. You don't do your 3D designs in there. That's what you use Maya, 3D Studio Max, Blender, whatever for. But as placeholders, you can do things like cubes and spheres and like that, which is great for me because I'm not a designer, and this is just the best I can do with graphical design, so I just use the sphere, I don't care. So it creates a sphere for me. Let me zoom in on it, and here it is. Now, on this side of the screen, over there, I can specify the dimension of this. And if I do this talk in the United States, I'm having a hard time at this moment. Because I have to tell them this is in meters. And you as people don't understand what a meter is. It's how many feet is that? No, it's meters. So it's a European company, Unity. They're from Denmark, so they think the right way about dimensions. This sphere is about a meter wide now in real life. If you are building a game, it doesn't really matter what you use. Units can be whatever you want. Centimeters, millimeters, kilometers, yards, miles, I don't care. But in the hollow world, this is a meter. So it's a bit big, so I'll make it 0.25. Ooh, that's not correct. I said 0.25. There you go. Okay, and now it's a bit smaller, so this, and it's around the center, so I will place it about 2 meters in front of me as a user. Let's add another one. Let's say, a sphere. Let's add a capsule. Why not? Again, let's make it smaller. 0.25. That's not correct again. That looks awful. That's 25 meters long. That's a bit much, isn't it? And I'm going to place it, let's say, 3 meters away from me, but a bit to the left as well. So in my scene view, it will look... Oh, I can't even see it. There we are. I can do all sorts of things with this. If I want to have some interaction with it, I need to have some code behind it, and the code needs to be aware when I'm tapping things, I told you about, or where I'm giving voice commands, or whatever happens. So I need to give it some commands. And to do this, I need to create some scripts. Let me first save my scene. And I'd like to put things in their own folders. So I'm going to make a folder called scenes and call this one main. A scene is a level, if you will. Think of it that way. Just saw the next speaker coming in. He knows everything about gaming, so he's probably not agreeing with me, but he's hiding in the corner. Okay. I'm going to make another game object, which again is just a placeholder, which I'll call managers. And that is just the thing I'm going to have some generic scripting. Create new folder scripts. You don't have to do this, but again, I like to keep my things tidy, and I'll create a new script. This is where the development part starts, but again, it's not very simple. I'll call it interaction. I don't want to be typing in all this code all the time, so I prepared this actually. There we go, interaction controller. I lost my mouse. Interaction. You can't read it anyway. I hope I didn't make a typo. No, I did not. Interaction controller. And the interaction controller is just a C# script, and it's going to be run all the time. It's part of my game, and the moment the game starts up, it will start running this script, which is just a simple and completely unreadable C# script file. You can use in Unity JavaScript or its own language, boo. But for HoloLens, it needs to be C# script. Okay, since you can't read it anyway, I'll just copy and paste it from here, and I will tell you what's going on. Okay. Again, like I said, HoloLens development is extremely simple. Don't show again. Go away. I have a method called start, and start will be called the moment that it starts. Makes sense, right? I also got a method called update, I'll show you later on, which is called in every single frame. This method can do whatever you want, but it's called every single frame. And a HoloLens application runs about 60 frames per second, so don't open a database connection to an Azure or an AWS cloud service and get in a million records from the database, because it will work, but you won't be able to do this in 1/60th of a second, which means that your frame rate will drop. So be careful there. Start is the thing that's being called the first thing. I'm making an instance of an object called the gesture recognizer. And then I say to the gesture recognizer, you know what? Recognize the tap, which is this. The moment you get a tap, call this method tapped and start do your work. And that's all I need to do to recognize this. 4 lines of code. I'm also making another one, which is called the keyword recognizer. And the keyword recognizer is the one that recognizes voice commands. So if I say something, it will recognize it. I don't need to train it. I don't need to do anything fancy. I just say, you know what? Give me a new keyword recognizer. Recognize word restore. And if you hear the word restore, go to this method phrase recognized and start. So that's 3 lines of code. So I've got voice recognition in my application in just 3 lines of code. I told you it was simple, right? Okay. Let's skip over this for now. I'm going to my my update method. Again, update is being called every single frame, so at least 60 times per second. So you need to be careful what you're doing there. I want to know what I'm looking at. Again, like I gave you the example, if I want to have an interaction with an object, I look at that object and I tell it to do something, or I tap while looking at it. But I need to know what I'm looking at. So what I'm doing is I make a raycast. Now, let's skip over this part. I don't need to forget that one. But a raycast is extremely simple. It's just, imagine you have a light of beam coming out of your head, going straight forward, and then you measure if it hits something. That's basically what it does. Well, that's what it does. Not basically, that's what it does. The moment it hits something, it will give you back information. This is the thing I've been touching. So you know where the user is looking, because it's wearing a device and looking at the direction. So what I do is simple. Okay, I say, okay, raycast. I give it a ray, again the light, and I say, okay, the ray is starting from the position of the camera. Again, the camera is the HoloLens, and it's going to be in the direction of straightforward. So no matter where the user is, this is where my ray is. Again, a light beam going straight at my head. If you hit something, just send it a message and tell it, hey, object, you've been hit. And then the object will do something. We'll skip over the rest, it's not very interesting, because I want to show you how it works. the tapped method, if we do this and we are looking at something, we're checking, did we look at something? If we did, then call the method, hey, you've been tapped. And for the voice command, if we heard a word, restore, I think I did, yeah, restore, then just call all the objects in our world and just restore them to their original position. That's basically what we're doing. I need to have the other script as well, which is just the code that handles all this kind of thing. It's very simple. If I can find Unity again, there is. Create new script. Hit handler. Okay. And the hit handler looks like this. Okay. Note to Dennis. Yeah, I've got notes here. The hit handler is is a script which is going to be attached to every single object that we want to interact with. And all that happens is it waits to be called from the other script saying, okay, you've been hit, do the hit thing, which means change color. Or if you have the tapped command, start falling down to the earth. That's basically what it does. And if it's being restored, then put it back in its old position. The details are definitely interesting, but it's really simple. Save. Let's go here. Okay, I need to do one important thing. Two important things. One is, I told you that HoloLens knows about the environment. It knows where the floors is. But in order to get that kind of thing, I need to tell it, start scanning for it. So I need some components which do the scanning for me. Start scanning the environment. I'll add those to the manager. I'll click add component and I can say, okay, I want the spatial mapping collider. And what this does is, if something hits something physical, the floor, the ceiling, whatever, tell me about this. Because we want the ball to stop falling, for instance. But I also want to be able to see what's going on, because, well, just kind of cool. So let me add the spatial renderer. And there we go. And the spatial renderer is the object that draws a visual mesh on top of everything that it sees. Now, there are two options. One, you can say, okay, just draw it, or don't draw it, but just hide anything which is underneath it. Let's draw it. Visualization. Okay, considering the time, I'm not going to deploy this. But the thing is, if I now run this, I can deploy to the HoloLens. I can start it up. And then it will draw these objects that I've created. I can look at them. The moment I look at them, it will change color because it knows I look at it. And if I give it the tap command, they will start falling. And if I give it the restore command, the voice command again, it will go back to its original position. I've got 3 minutes. Building this takes about 5. So I'm not going to do this. I did have a preparation though. I can show you what's going on by putting on HoloLens. I tried this out earlier, so the thing is, I can, oh, this is going to be hard over my microphone. I can show you what things look like on the HoloLens, if I put it down correctly. It needs a network connection, so I'm going to connect it to my laptop. Come on, please don't notice my password. Don't use it. I'll change it later on. There is a web server on board of this device, which means that everything that's being projected here can also be transmitted to any device that listens to it. Are we connected? No, not yet, but we will. Which means that I can open a browser and I can connect to the device and then I can share what I'm seeing with you guys. So let me fire up the browser. I'm still not connected. Come on, you can do this. Let's go to my IP address. Let me connect. I know this looks silly. Dennis Sada, there we are. Connecting. Okay, cool. And what's my IP address? Nothing yet. Why does this always take a lot of time when you don't have any time at all? Just want to show you. Come on. It doesn't want to connect. That's a bummer. Okay, I've got one last resort. Because I really do want to show you. I'm sorry, Roel, you're going to have to wait for a sec. If you start developing HoloLens, you can use your you can deploy to USB cable or to Wi-Fi. My advice to you is never use the cable. I'm going to do this right now because it doesn't connect. The reason that you don't want to do this because the moment you put it on, you start walking around. And when you attach to a cable and you start walking around, you will pull your laptop off the table. Have a look at mine. It's broken all sides because I put it on with a cable on, and the moment I started to walk around, I dragged it off the table. So I can just connect now, come on, to this device. Have a little hack. This is the one. Yeah. There we go. Okay, and this is what it looks like. Now, you guys will have a 6-second delay. So this is not what I'm seeing. I'm seeing it in real time. But you'll have a 6-second delay. This is because, well, it's a very slow device. But this is what I'm seeing. So I see the audience. I see you guys in there. And I see this menu. And I can go to the menu and I can select an application. And I've completely forgot the way I called it. Oh, that's the wrong one. Let's go there. There's too many applications here. Oh, there it is. So this is the one I built. It will show up. There it is. Again, the splash screen. Again, if you have got the paid version, you can turn this off. I don't have this on this machine. And I made a mistake. And there's my sphere. You see the thing dropping already. And there's the sphere. And if I look at it, it will change color. And if I tap on it, it will fall. But it starts scanning first. And this is the way it sees the world. As you can see, it starts scanning things a bit, and that's what of course in production applications you turn off this mesh, but so if I tap on the ball, it will fall and it will remain on the floor. And if I say restore, it will be back up, and there's the cylinder again. So for the cylinder goes the same kind of thing. Don't you just want to kick it and play around with the ball a bit? I usually like to drop it on my audience, but okay, I'm not gonna do this time. So the code I've shown you is extremely simple. Just a couple of lines of code to do the magical kind of thing. The rest is just boilerplate. It's kind of boring. The hard thing is come up with a great idea. So if you've got some great ideas, come talk to me afterwards. I'll be in the hallway outside. And if you want to try it out a bit, be my guest. I don't think we can have everybody on the device because it's going to be a long time. But if you want to have a go, then please be my guest. And enjoy the last talks of the day. And thank you so far.